Hi, my name is Tony Mee. St. Patrick's Day is an opportunity to celebrate the American immigration story. My husband, John, and I sat in a pub in coastal Maine one Sunday afternoon last fall when the conversation turned to a common topic. My husband, a contractor who builds and repairs marine structures such as piers and docks, and a mutual friend in the same line of work both lamented the universal difficulty of hiring staff. My husband, who is Irish, said we had better start attracting some immigrants to Maine who have building skills. His friend nodded and replied, "Definitely. Once they're illegal." I glanced at John but said nothing. His face didn't change, and as the conversation shifted again, I wondered if this friend knew my husband overstayed his tourist visa on his initial trip to the United States in 2002 and was not legal when we first met. Where we sat, on a wharf with the cold Atlantic Ocean under the floor, our stools were less than 300 miles from the border, the Canadian border. Yet I wasn't surprised by the word legal in our conversation, because border security was being debated across the country by midterm election candidates, regardless of geography. The falsehood spread through this disproportionate focus on security in relation to immigration policy perpetuates a false binary of legal and illegal. This March 17, my two Irish-born children will proudly trundle off to a school wearing their green and gold Kerry Gaelic Athletic Association jerseys and revel in the one-day celebrity status being Irish in America. Gives them on St. Patrick's Day. Ireland was my adopted home for over 10 years, but this St. Patrick's Day might leave a sour taste in my mouth, and it won't be from a stale pint of Guinness. Since moving back to my native United States from Ireland in 2015, the increase in political and reductionist rhetoric surrounding immigration, one that labels immigrants as criminals to be arrested and deported until proven otherwise, demonstrates a fundamental lack of understanding about the scope and depth of immigration in our country. John's and my immigration story is so intertwined with our relationship that I often forget it is also intrinsically political. I can in some ways afford to forget this because my husband is a white immigrant with a green card that took 10 years to get. I can also forget because the current American narrative on immigration is largely confined to debates over the U.S.-Mexico border. My family doesn't exist in today's debate, a debate fixated on border security and not on the lack of humanity or efficacy of our immigration regulations and systems of administration. A debate that does not account for a whole spectrum of citizens and residents whose family stories are also intertwined with their migration stories. Immigrants and their U.S.-born children now number approximately 89.4 million, or 28% of the overall population, according to the 2018 Current Population Survey. That's quite a lot of voices missing from our current dialogue on the immigration issue. Despite the reality of more than 11 million undocumented experiences, many Americans continue to believe in a mythical line to visas. The lack of factual context results in people believing there was an avenue for my husband to come legally in 2002, or for hypothetical workers now. Without a family-sponsored visa, workers without college degrees have few options for obtaining permanent legal status or even temporary work visas. Only 10.9% and 5.1% of non-immigrant temporary admissions granted by DHS in 2017, respectively, were either for temporary visitors for business or for temporary workers and their families. Citizens or legal permanent residents are eligible to sponsor immediate family members for immigrant visas. Immediate relatives include only spouses of U.S. citizens, unmarried children younger than 21 citizens, and parents of adult citizens. This is how I sponsor Johnny's immigrant visa, or green card. It took 3 years. Wait times for an applicant to even be assessed and vetted can range from 10 to 20 years for brothers and sisters of U.S. citizens from the Philippines and Mexico. This is getting in line. Define American, founded by author and immigrant Jose Antonio Vargas, hopes to shift the conversation about immigration, identity and citizenship beyond political rhetoric through human stories. St. Patrick's Day could be one of these opportunities to reflect on who currently defines American, as it stands in 2019. Our willingness to turn green with drunken glee or buy an estimated $850 million worth of genealogical testing kits to trace our ethnicity is hard to reconcile with our country's inhumane treatment of asylum seekers and their children. Arriving in New York from Dublin in 2014, Frances Mulroney also felt a sense of discomfort at how her welcome to America differed from others. I've had strangers want to hug me for being Irish and my immigration status is never questioned by anyone, something I felt was down to being white and Irish, she said. Frances told me she came on a temp graduate visa that lets Irish students apply for internships within 90 days of arrival. An Irish media company then sponsored her on an employment visa when she got hired. After starting work with that company, Irish Central, in 2015, she joined Irish Stand, a grassroots movement that fights for civil rights protection for all immigrants and calls on Irish and U.S. politicians to reconcile their heritage and national experience with their anti-immigration policies. I love celebrating Irishness, particularly our language. But it is wrong to think anyone here can celebrate St. Patrick's Day and not also be celebrating an identity as an immigrant and the impact of immigrants on American identity in general, Mulroney told me. My 9-year-old son recently announced he might want to run for president. My slogan could be, "Vote for the Irish man," he said. I laughed and explained he might have to set a precedent since most interpretations of the Constitution conclude he can't hold that office. To him, his status as both Irish and American is natural. He is lucky in his privilege to believe his immigrant status could be a winning campaign slogan, that we instead choose to debate over political candidates' validity as Americans. Rather than amend the Constitution is telling about the United States' confused identity. Thankfully, there is no shortage of people to tell the real story of millions of immigration stories, and St. Patrick's Day is an opportunity to humanize our nation's conversation about immigration. It is my hope that while the 34 million of us who claim Irish ancestry sip Guinness and boil cabbage on March 17, we also consider our role in honoring the experience of millions of Irish refugees throughout history by insisting on policy that reflects the facts of our nation, policy that creates incentives for safe and efficient legal immigration options that match today's global workforce and economy. Thank you for watching. For the follow-up, subscribe to the channel yourself here. Hi, my name is Tony Mee. Just beaming, crowds celebrate St. Patrick's Day during downtown parade. Spring may not have arrived yet, but there was plenty of green to be seen Saturday afternoon in downtown Chicago for the annual St. Patrick's Day parade. Revelers wore green caps, fedoras, bandanas and crowns, wigs, both curly and straight, shamrock-shaped bead necklaces and feather boas, pants in plaid, stripes and Lucky Charms elf patterns. Capes, dresses and suits all green, and many with sparkles. Along the way to the parade route on South Columbus Drive, vendors sold pizzas, green hats, t-shirts and Girl Scout cookies. Bella Can, 12, sold Girl Scout cookies out of a wagon with her mother on Michigan Avenue as people walked to the parade, but she wasn't planning on attending it herself. It had been a busy morning, and their supply of Samos already needed to be replenished. Diana Can, her mother, said they'd sold around 200 boxes that day. "Everyone's just going around, it's crazy," Bella said. She usually sells the cookies every day to people in her neighborhood in downstate Bowling Green and hopes to break her record from last year, 5,200 boxes. She's halfway there with a month to go. Another mother and daughter pair came to watch the parade wearing matching green sparkly sunglasses and feather boas. Kathy McGigan, 67, and Tracy Fasano, 35, said they've gone to the parade every year together for the last 7 years. They keep a box with accessories and plan their outfits together. Every year is better than the next, Fasano said. Floats playing Irish music rolled by, marching bands stepped to the beat, and people threw candy, green bead necklaces and tiny soft footballs at those in the crowd, who eagerly held up their hands and cheered. John Ruddy, 65, who was there with his extended family, said a highlight of the day was seeing the Chicago River as it was dyed green Saturday morning. It's quite a production, Ruddy said. It was followed by kayakers who came up and down the river, then there was the personal boats, pleasure boats, just beaming with St. Patrick's Day celebrants. Though Ruddy's family has Irish heritage and celebrates St. Patrick's Day with a weekend of events in Chicago and by eating corned beef, soda bread and cabbage. Many just came for the fun and spectacle. Emily Peterson, 35, came from the Quad Cities area with her boyfriend, Joey Amato, 49, to see the parade. Amato wore a green mohawk and an orange beard wig. Neither of them is Irish. We just like the spirit of it, Peterson said of the holiday. Although many children attended, holding hands or sitting on the shoulders of parents, the atmosphere wasn't completely family-friendly. People in the crowd sometimes drank and took shots, and there was a strong smell of beer and marijuana in the air. Jose Saldana, 34, was there with his 5-year-old daughter, Catalina, and her mother. He said they trust the police to control the crowd and try to steer Catalina away from the rowdier people in the crowd. They laughed at how things have changed now that they have a family. We were there at one age, Saldana said. Like 21. Not everyone was there to have fun, though, including Chicago police officers Elisa Velasquez, 30, and Jasmine Stewart, 26, who were stationed along the parade route on Columbus near Balboa Avenue. We're hungry and cold, Stewart said. Velasquez said it had been a relatively calm day, nothing crazy happened, but someone climbed into the Buckingham Fountain for a picture. She said a holiday could be fun, as long as the parade-goers contain themselves and don't do anything stupid. Thank you for watching. For the follow-up, subscribe to the channel yourself here. Hi, my name is Tony Mee. Chicago mayoral hopefuls take back seat to fighter Conor McGregor at St. Patrick's Day Parade. Chicago mayoral hopefuls Tony Perkwinkle and Lori Lightfoot are a little more than 2 weeks away from a historic election. But there was little evidence of the political showdown at Saturday's downtown St. Patrick's Day Parade. There were few political signs or buttons. Ropes and police officers around the dignitaries kept either candidate from working the crowd. And if there were any shouts from the masses for Lightfoot or Perkwinkle, they were drowned out by the frenzy that greeted famous Irish mixed martial arts fighter Conor McGregor. The 15-minute march down Columbus Drive also marked Rahm Emanuel's 8th and final as mayor, but he wasn't feeling wistful. I'm going to kick his ass, Emanuel joked as he pointed to McGregor next to him, moments before the parade stepped off. McGregor, who sported a pair of green suede shoes, reacted with just a smirk. The mayor did not appear too great to either of the candidates running to succeed him. He's had a rocky relationship with both. As Emmanuel, McGregor and Irish Prime Minister Leo Varadkar walked the route front and center, Perkwinkle was off to the right, just past Governor J.B. Pritzker. Lightfoot, sporting a green plaid Blackhawks fedora, walked with her wife, Amy Eshelman, and 11-year-old daughter, Vivian, to the far left on the other side of U.S. Senator Dick Durbin. When the dignitaries reached the reviewing stand near Buckingham Fountain, the MC mentioned Emmanuel, Pritzker, Durbin and Perkwinkle by name to little reaction. There was no mention of Lightfoot or the mayor's race. While there may not have been much fanfare, Lightfoot and Perkwinkle both relished the moment. It feels like a great honor, it really does, Lightfoot said of passers-by recognizing her and wishing her well. Coming from where I come from and the journey I've been on, particularly over this last year, it's gratifying that a lot of the hard work by so many people is showing up. Because so many people are enthusiastic for change. Lightfoot's victory in the first round election last month punctuated the 56-year-old former federal prosecutor's rise from political obscurity into a one-on-one race in the April 2 runoff. Lightfoot, who held two police oversight appointments under Emanuel and worked in police oversight and agency positions under former Mayor Richard M. Daley, had never walked in the parade before. She did, however, remember attending her first when she was still an undergraduate student at the University of Michigan. "I came to Chicago for the first time when I was a freshman in college for St. Patrick's Day," Lightfoot said, before cracking a joke. "I won't tell you what happened, crimes and misdemeanors committed." As alderman for nearly 20 years and Cook County Board President for 9, Prickwinkle knew the drill. She was more grateful for sunny skies and temperatures in the upper 30s than anything else. "I've been doing this quite a long time. The big difference is the weather," Prickwinkle said with a laugh. "I've been out here when it's been pouring down rain and when it's freezing. It's a beautiful day." The 71-year-old chair of the Cook County Democratic Party said she feels good with a little more than 2 weeks to go in the campaign. "I'm really optimistic," she said. "As I go around the city, I get a warm reception and I'm very grateful for the resonance of my message of the importance of investing in our neighborhoods and our neighborhood schools. Community revitalization and addressing public safety challenges." Other politicians weren't as eager to talk about the race. "I think it's a very interesting race, thank you," Durbin said quickly, two laughs when asked about the matchup. "I'm not going to be endorsing in that race." Pritzker also made it clear he's staying out of the fray, but pointed out the historic nature of the nation's third-largest city being poised to elect its first African-American female mayor. "Well, it's very competitive, and we're going to make history in Chicago. I'm very proud of that fact," Pritzker said. "The voters are going to make up their own minds, and I'm proud of the fact that people are running a tough campaign. This is a good city, tough people, and we're going to get a good mayor out of it." As the current mayor joked about going a round or two with McGregor, Emanuel was asked if he had any advice for the two candidates vying for his fifth-floor office at City Hall. "My advice? Keep offering ideas," the mayor said. As Bill Clinton said, "Ideas are the most undervalued, underappreciated but most important things you can offer." Asked if the candidates had offered enough ideas to his liking, Emanuel offered a long pause before offering a restrained answer. "Thank you for watching. For the follow-up, subscribe to the channel yourself here."Hi, my name is Tony Mee. Everyone is Irish for San Francisco's St. Patrick's Day Parade. It wasn't St. Patrick's Day and hardly anyone was Irish, but that didn't stop tens of thousands of folks from grabbing anything green from the closet. Grabbing a beer or three and standing on the Market Street sidewalk to do the St. Patrick's Day parade thing. It involved cops with horses, kids with tubas, old fellows with bagpipes, girls with Irish dance clogs and classic cars with tops down. Green beads were around necks, and green hats were atop heads. Everything else was green, too, fermented beverages included. Emilio Ramos of San Francisco was enjoying himself, even though he is 4 months old. Perhaps it was because he was wearing earplugs to keep the drumming and bagpiping out. "I'm not sure he likes all the noise, but he seems to be having fun," said his mother, Julia. "It's his first parade, his first time to see a mayor, his first time to see bagpipes. It's his first everything." The annual thing started at 1130 a.m., exactly on time, if a day early. St. Patrick's Day actually falls on Sunday. The procession moved west from 2nd and Market Streets, down the grand thoroughfare of San Francisco and on to Civic Center. Past sidewalks full of one-day-a-year Dubliners. Leading off were the big shots. Mayor London Breed waved, then waved some more. Police Chief Bill Scott handed out stickers to kids, then handed out some more. The line of honorary grand marshals seemed to go on forever, along with the dancers and motorized cable cars and the brass bands with their tuba players. One of the tuba players, Joe Flores, 16, of the Fresno High School Band, said the most important rule about playing the tuba is not to whine about how heavy it is. Asked what the Fresno High School Band would be playing, Flores smiled and said he wasn't really sure. Probably a lot of songs that drunk people like to hear, he said. Drum major Mervin Samioa of the Anaheim High School Band was doing some of his best baton twirling. He said he has never dropped his baton in performance and did not intend to break the streak in San Francisco. It's all timing, he said. You know where the baton is. You don't have to look at it. You're not supposed to. See? There's not a dent on mine. About 24 Irish Wolfhounds were there, because Irish Wolfhounds haven't had a lot of other things to do since driving the last wolf out of Ireland in 1786. They were all members of the Northern California Irish Wolfhound Club. Arlo the Wolfhound was busy getting acquainted with the rear end of Clover the Wolfhound. That's just what wolfhounds do, said Clover's owner, Susie Johnston of Sacramento. You always want an Irish Wolfhound in a St. Patrick's Day parade. They're the keepers of the Irish soul. Bagpipers were there, in overwhelming numbers. Piper Michael Ubar of the Silicon Valley Pipe Band said that could be because he is not required to play Danny Boy this year. I'm not a big fan of that song, he said. I'll play it if I have to. It's not really a bagpipe song. His fellow Irish bagpiper Daryl Turner said the great thing about a bagpipe is that it's always on. There's a drone sound that keeps playing when the rest of the tune is over. In other words, he said, you can't shut a bagpipe up. It never stops, he said. It's such a plaintive, emotional sound. And St. Patrick's is the high holy day of bagpipes. The line of Irish wannabes, many with tykes on their shoulders, continued all the way to a civic center. This year the annual festival with booths and music was cancelled, enabling parade-goers to skip the niceties and head directly to the retinue of Irish pubs around town. Many bought tickets to events called pub crawls, a tradition that started even before the Wolfhounds last did their wolf thing in 1786. In San Francisco, there were enough pub crawl fans to fuel at least three such endeavors. The Leprechaun Please Drink Responsibly. The luck of the Irish Bar Drawl. Get buzzed with your friends and the Kiss Me I'm Irish Bar Crawl. Best bars in town. The responsible pub crawling runs from 11 a.m. to 8 p.m. and involves wristbands. Other kinds begin earlier and end later. Cops were out, all over town. They were not fooled by brown paper bags. Also on duty, keeping the order, was bar bouncer Pedro Diaz, stationed in front of Kate O'Brien's Irish pub at Howard and Second Streets. His job was to keep the beer on the premises. A good bouncer, he said, stays calm and reasonable, which helps if you're bigger than the inebriated person you're trying to reason with, as Diaz was. Today is really unlike any other day, he said. Most days, people don't usually start drinking at 10 in the morning. Today they do. Thank you for watching. For the follow-up, subscribe to the channel yourself here. Hi, my name is Tony Mee. All your burning St. Patrick's Day questions answered. Every March 17th, the world suddenly looks a bit greener as people don the color to celebrate St. Patrick's Day. From shamrocks and leprechauns to corned beef and green beer, here's what you need to know about the holiday. What is St. Patrick's Day? St. Patrick's Day is the feast day of St. Patrick, who is the patron saint of Ireland. In addition to its religious roots, the holiday has become synonymous with the color green, shamrocks and festive drinking. St. Patrick was a Christian missionary who converted the Irish people to Christianity. He was born in Britain in 385 AD and brought to Ireland as a slave when he was 16. 6 years later, he escaped to a French monastery, became a priest and returned to Ireland to spread the teachings of Christianity. Legend says that he also drove the snakes out of Ireland. However, biologists say there were never any snakes in Ireland in the first place. How do people celebrate? St. Patrick's Day is primarily celebrated as a religious holiday in Ireland. Banks, stores and businesses shut down for the national holiday. Traditionally, the Irish go to church in the morning and pray for missionaries. Drinking, dancing and music are also part of the festivities later in the day. Most of the U.S. celebrates the occasion as a secular holiday. The first St. Patrick's Day celebration in America was held in Boston in 1737. Today, there are huge parades in New York City, Chicago and Savannah, Georgia, as well. Although the traditional meal eaten on the holiday in Ireland is lamb or bacon, Irish Americans eat corned beef and cabbage. Why are there shamrocks everywhere? Legend has it that St. Patrick used a three-leaf clover, otherwise known as a shamrock, to explain the concept of the Holy Trinity to pagans. Shamrocks are also the national flower emblem of Ireland. Why is everything green? The original color of St. Patrick's Day was actually blue. But over time, green won out. The color green is a nod to Ireland's nickname, the Emerald Isle. Wearing green on St. Patrick's Day is supposed to prevent you from getting pinched by a leprechaun. Leprechauns are tricky mythical fairies in Irish folklore who like to pinch anyone in sight. However, legend says that wearing green makes you invisible to these feisty creatures. The color is also politically symbolic. Green is associated with the Irish nationalist movement against the English crown in the 1600s. And when Irish immigrants came to America, they wore green to show pride for their home country. Thank you for watching. For the follow-up, subscribe to the channel yourself here.